Hello, am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for attending. Today, here at PyCon 2016, we will be speaking on real-time sentiment analysis with Apache Storm. A brief intro about ourselves. My name is Sheikh Asifullah, and here with me is Pritam Purbia. We both are software engineers at Walmart Labs, graduated from BITS Pilani, and we both are great Python lovers, as you all are. So let's get started with Apache Storm. But before that, I want to know how many of you have already used Storm. People can raise their hands in order to have quick numbers, please. Okay, great. So for those who don't know, Storm is for those who wants to have computations done on big data in real time and in a very quick way. So Storm was originally created by Nathan Merz and his team at Backtype. It was mainly developed in Java and Clojure. Then later Twitter acquired it and they open sourced it. We all know what big data is. Big data is about 4 V's: volume, velocity, veracity, and variety. So in today's world, there are small companies and big companies. Everyone is trying to scale themselves up, and everyone is trying to work on big data. So the data about big data is itself so huge that it demands some awesome tool to process the amount of data that is being generated. And Storm is one such tool that helps you to solve most of the big data related problems. We are in the world of Twitter. I think many of you might tweet often. So millions and millions of tweets come into Twitter daily, and Twitter has to have its own mechanisms to process the amount of tweets that are coming in. And for that, they have to do analytics on that and do computations on that big data. So Twitter uses Apache Storm. Say you are following a famous personality, and whenever he tweets something, you including other followers must get an update of that particular tweet in real time. So it uses Apache Storm for many use cases like trending topics, or top and hashtags, or many other things. So by this, you can understand the power of Apache Storm and how it is being used and where it is being used. So why you should be using Storm? So in today's world, there are IoT devices. A lot of research work is going on IoT devices now. So there are IoT devices that are generating streams and streams of data. There is neuroscience that is generating gigabytes of data in a second. That is pretty huge, actually. And then there are trading companies, financial companies that are competing against each other with their trading algorithms that are fighting for the latency in milliseconds. And then there are corporates who wants to have business intelligence reports generated on big data in real time and in a very quick way. So Storm solves all these problems. So why you should be using Storm, why you should love Storm is because of these reasons. It is simple, it's not complex at all, and it is distributed. So you don't run Storm on one node. You run Storm on multiple machines so that whatever computation you have that is actually kind of distributed among all the machines, and so that the results that you want to get will be much faster. You can make Storm run on one machine too, but that is not what Storm is intended for. And this is the main distinguishing feature of Storm. It is real-time processing system. So if you want to process messages on the fly, so then you can use Storm. I don't know much about Hadoop, but when I started working on big data, I started with Apache Storm, so I don't find big data analysis is hard or time consuming. And with the processing speed that the Storm displays, I'm always amazed. And it's fault tolerant. So if any of the component in the Storm architecture dies or fails off, Storm has its own mechanisms to retry or to restart it, so that you don't have to worry about that. Storm will take care of its own. And this is the best thing about Storm. It is easy to scale in Storm. So if you want to add a new node into the existing Storm cluster, you just need to download tar.gz file, storm.gz file, and change the storm.yml configuration in that, and tell storm.yml about the cluster information, and that's it. You are connected to the cluster. It's so easy. And last but not the least, it's very, very fast. And it's there in the main page of documentation that if it is properly configured, then it can process 1 million tuples per second. That's great, actually. But what was there before Storm? Before Storm, people actually use Hadoop. Even now, people use Hadoop, but before Storm, that was the only option back then. I know a little bit about Hadoop. In Hadoop, we have MapReduce for computation, and then we have HDFS for storage. So, but from the previous slide, we got to know that Storm is a real-time processing system, and to make Hadoop a real-time processing system as Storm is, it's impossible. And to match up with the low latency that the Storm provides, it's impossible with Hadoop. What instead Hadoop provides is the batch processing system. What do you mean by batch processing is that as you get the data, you store that data in some database, and you create batches out of that database and run analytics on those batches. So Storm, since Storm is a real-time processing system, you won't be doing that. You will be processing one tuple at a time in a distributed way, and so that the computations are much faster and quicker. And people often bring out this analogy when they compare Storm with Hadoop, like people waiting for the elevator to come in and people happily going down through escalator, representing that as a batch processing and this as a real-time processing. But both have their own use cases actually. If you want to do batch processing, then you can go with Hadoop, but if you want to do a real-time processing, then you can go with any streaming thing, Apache Storm in our case. So that actually depends on your latency. If you want your results to be displayed in minute wise or the second wise, if your latency is milliseconds or seconds or maybe in minutes, then you can go with Storm. But if it is larger, then Hadoop is there for you. People actually have kind of a feeling that Hadoop is the best choice for machine learning kind of problems, where you have large data set, large trained data that you want to actually apply on your batch so that you can get the computations out of that, we can make predictions analytics over that. But with Storm 0.10, they provide a distributed cache API where you can share your Python dictionaries or train data as blobs to Storm, and Storm will actually kind of distribute that among the different nodes that are there in Storm cluster. So, and it allows for compression too, and you can change your blobs while the Storm job is still running so that you can have zero downtime. And text blobs are the great thing. You can use that Python library is there. You can use that if you want to. Now let's come into our sentiment analyzer. So to build our sentiment analyzer, first we need to collect some data. I think Twitter is the best thing because we can get streaming tweets through Twitter API. There are a lot of libraries available out there. You can use Twitter streaming API. You can use TweePy library. That is also great. But there is one drawback using TweePy. You won't be getting all tweets. It says that you can get from 1% to 40% of tweets that Twitter has for a particular keyword. If you want to make a POC kind of thing, then it's easy to go with TweePy library. But if you want to make an enterprise product, then you can go with Twitter Firehose. Actually, that actually sends you 100% of tweets that Twitter has for a particular keyword. So first you need to collect data and then prettify it. That you can decide if you want to remove any unwanted columns out of that, unwanted fields, or remove any special characters that you want, that you don't need for sentiment analyzer to analyze on it, like @, hash, or any other thing that you don't want. So after prettifying it, you extract whatever you want out of that tweet. Here in our case, it may be a text, or maybe emoticons, or number of retweets, number of likes, whatever metrics you want to extract out of the text, and then give it to sentiment analyzer. Sentiment analyzer will now analyze whatever the arguments you have passed, and that will give you a score actually. That you kind of organize the result from the sentiment analyzer and also from the prettify thing, so that you actually join both the results into one thing, and then you store it in some DB and then display the results. So the displaying results can come before storing in DB. That is actually the use case of Storm here. So you can display the minute-wise sentiment change or the real-time sentiment change for a particular tweet, but you can also store it in some DB like Cassandra, in which writes are much faster. So you can store in some DB and run PySpark on it and then get visualizations out of it. And there is Zeppelin for Spark. If you don't know, you can use it for visualization too. I heard that Spark doesn't have good visualizations, but you can use Zeppelin to get better visualizations out of the data that is stored there. So this is the workflow that I was talking about. You get that tweet from Twitter. Now you are actually prettifying it. I don't want this @postgrad problem over here. I don't want it to send to sentiment analyzer. So I kind of prettified that text. So I removed all the junk over there, and you can remove other fields too, like if you don't want truncated, you can remove it. And then after doing the prettifying thing, then you extract the text. I just extracted text over here, so I got only Python school, and then I give it to sentiment analysis. Sentiment analysis give me a score there, sentiment equals to 1.0, so that it gives. So that I will store it in some DB and then, so after the result from the sentiment analysis, you just join both the prettified thing and the sentiment analysis result into one, and then you can store it in some MongoDB or it can be a CassandraDB or any other database actually, and then run Spark over that DB, or you can show the sentiment change in the graph itself before storing it in DB. So give me 1 minute. So from the Storm's perspective, this is how it looks. So whatever that is fetching you the data, that is getting the data from some external source, that is generating the data, so that is called spout. And whatever you are doing actions on the data generated, those are called bolts. And the edges between spout and bolt and bolt and bolt are represents the stream of tuples that you are actually sending in. So spout actually takes data from different sources. It may be a Twitter streaming API, it may be a Firehose, or it may be any other API, or it may be Kestrel queue, or it can listen to any Kafka topic maybe. So after getting data, it converts into a tuple which is an immutable data structure and then forwards it to the next node. So bolts are the one where the actions are being done. So after doing all the actions, you can just emit it or you can pass it in some database. So actually in spout, there are two things, there is reliable spout and there is unreliable spout. If you want to make sure that whatever you are sending should always get processed, then you can use reliable spout. For that you can do hacking thing. But in case of unreliable spout, you don't have to, if you don't need whether that is actually processed or not, so you can make it as unreliable spout, and spout actually ignores that after emitting it into this thing, storm job. And the whole connectivity is called topology, which is actually a directed acyclic graph. So the connectivity between spout and bolts together comprises a topology, and these are the storm concepts that you should know. And Pritham will now tell you how to deploy storm in remote cluster. Over to you, Pritham.
Yeah. So hi, I'm Pritham. So if you see here, there is a topology, and you can see there are two sources, and there are multiple processing units, those we called as bolt. So let's say if I am reading data from Twitter and I am also reading some logs, let's say from Kafka, and I want to combine them and generate a trend, let's say how many logs got generated for that tweet. So this how you can build a topology. So there can be multiple sources and multiple bolts. So before we go deep into it, let me talk about some of the terminologies we use for Storm. So topology is a directed acyclic graph. So you have multiple sources and the tuple is flowing down till the leaf node of the topology. So each bolt can do some actions. So let's say I am processing one tweet. I am generating, let's say, prettified text, and also I'm generating raw text. I'm forwarding to the next level. So in this topology, there are spouts. So spout is nothing but the data source. So data source can be a reader to Kafka, reading from MySQL, reading from, let's say, any other queuing system, or maybe reading from file itself. So you have to write those adapters on top of it. And spout, as I said, there can be multiple spout, and you can do aggregation and join. So let's talk about bolts. So bolts are the actual computational units which will actually take the tuple inside and then do processing on top of it. So let's say there are two bolts in my entire topology. So let's say spout send that signal to bolt. Now bolt did some computation and then forward it to next bolt. So this how it happens, and there can be multiple bolts. So let's say one bolt's input output can go to multiple bolts input. So tuple is nothing but the immutable object which is traversing inside the DAG. So it starts from when spout is there, spout will read data and create a tuple, and then it will traverse the path wherever it is configured, and it will reach to the leaf bolt, and that's where you either you plot that data to the graph or store into database. And the tuple tree is nothing but the path it is traversing. The let's say started from spout, and that particular tuple reached to let's say two bolts at the leaf layer. So that is the tuple tree he created. So let's talk about some of the artifacts which we use for Storm. So very first thing is Nimbus. So when we create a topology, we use a Nimbus to submit that topology into the cluster. So a basic topology can be a reading from Kafka and writing into Cassandra. So if you, so there, we, what we need is one spout, one bolt. And in that case, I will just generate that artifact topology, and then I will deploy that topology with the help of Nimbus APIs. And Nimbus, again, it is running on Thrift, so any wrapper can be developed. So it is, again, multiple languages can be used for writing the topology or creating your own custom spouts, custom bolts. Let's talk about supervisor. So as I discussed, the role of Nimbus is submitting the topology, and one more item is there, assignment and reassignment of the work. So supervisor is the process which will actually execute the work. So there will be multiple workers inside it. So let's say I have two supervisor, then the work will be divided among those two supervisor, and there will be multiple workers inside those supervisors. So we'll discuss that later. And zookeeper. So as we know, the distributed any distributed system is having challenge of coordination. So here the coordination mainly used with the help of zookeeper. Also supervisor talk each other with the netty so that they can hand over the work to other next hope. So let's talk about the cluster, how it looks like. So let's say I'm setting up, let's say I have 10 machines. Let's say one machine is having 4 cores. And so what I will do, I will see, okay, I have 10 machines, then I can create, first I need very minimum thing is zookeeper. So zookeeper, I have option, I can create zookeeper for 3 nodes or 5 nodes. Let's say I go for 3 nodes. Then if I increase number of nodes for zookeeper, then too much data transfer will happen. So your bandwidth will be consumed. So let's say I am taking 3 nodes zookeeper, and then I will take 1 node for Nimbus deployment where I can do all operations. Let's say I want to deploy the UI, Storm UI, I want to deploy the Nimbus, and I want to perform those operations on that topology. Let's say the remaining, let's say I have 8 or 9 machines, and on those 9 machines I will deploy supervisor. Supervisor is nothing but a process which will have a configuration file, and there you will define, okay, these many ports or these many workers I want to use. I think Ashif is going to talk about that.
And these are the kind of Storm internals that is happening inside inside your cluster. There is one Nimbus, there are zookeepers for coordination, and then there are supervisors that are set up on multiple machines. So so as of now, Storm people call it as a soft point of failure. So if Nimbus goes down, so your topology will still be running, nothing will be affected, but the reassignment of work is not going to happen. So say supervisor is down, well, the Nimbus is down, so the whatever the tasks that have been assigned to supervisor, that won't get reassigned to other supervisors. So but with Storm 0.10, they have introduced HEA Nimbus, highly availability Nimbus. So in that we have multiple instances of Nimbus, where if one Nimbus goes down, the other Nimbus can become leader and do all the coordination, all the assignment kind of thing. So so this is the property that we are going to set over here. So in the storm.yml, you actually need to set these two properties to configure zookeepers in which nodes they are in. You need to use this storm.zookeeper.servers, and then use the ports that are there to create that many workers on each machine. So in each supervisor machine, so you have different workers that are running in, that are running on each port. We have configured it as four ports, so each worker will be working on one port. And within worker, we have further executors. So this is kind of parallelism kind of thing. So you have Nimbus, that is actually the leader, and the supervisors that are actually the followers. Within supervisor, you have workers, and within workers, you have executors. These are the executors, these are the instances of your spouts and bolts. So you create that many instances of spout and bolts according to the parallelism that you require, and those executors will take up the task from the Nimbus, and that will compute your whatever computation that you need to make. And the communication between inter worker will be going with Netty. Earlier it was 0MQ, but with Storm 0.9, since they were since they get Apache license, they were using Netty because there were some license issues. And intra worker communication is happening through LMAX disruptor. There are LMAX disruptor backed by messaging queues. So that is how all the communication is happening. And the stream grouping. So whatever instances you create in spout and bolt, so if you want to control what instance of spout should talk to what instance of bolt, so all that can be controlled with stream grouping. There are many other types of stream grouping, but I have listed only four so that you can understand what actually stream grouping is. So in shuffle grouping, say you created three instances of bolt 1 and two instances of bolt 2, any instance of bolt 1 can emit tuple to any instance of bolt 2. So that is actually kind of random thing, but Storm will take care in order to distribute it better. And fields grouping, if you want to say you are counting number of words in a sentence, so actually you want to aggregate whatever the tuples that are there into one particular instance, so that you can direct to one particular instance. For that you have to do fields grouping. So all the tuples that have the particular keyword Java will go to the same instance of the bolt 2, and the tuples that have the keyword Python will go to the same instance of bolt 2. And all grouping will emit all these things to all the instance of other bolt, and global grouping any instance of the other bolt. People, you want to talk about this thing?
Yeah, so as Storm says that every event will be processed at least once. So there is a guarantee that whatever is read with the help of a spout will be processed at least once. There is a possibility that if there is a transaction failure or there is a timeout, it can come back the same, let's say if I'm reading from Kafka, that same event can come back. But overall, if you see, there is a 100% guarantee that it will be processed at least once. And we can go deeper into it, like how it is.
So actually, when a spout emits, it converts the tuple into a 64-bit ID that actually sends to the hacker. And every bolt, when it receives the tuple, that again converts into a 64-bit ID that will be again sent to the hacker. And hacker will do XOR operation on both the IDs. If the result is zero, then it is match. And if the result is not zero, then it got to know that somewhere it got failed. And if it is a reliable spout, it will replay the tuple actually. Now let's build a small program that actually counts the number of words in a sentence. So this is how you actually write code for spout. So we will be using Ptrl library, because in Ptrl you can actually create the entire thing, entire topology. You can create spouts, bolts and everything, and you can change the configuration in the topology.yml thing, and then you submit to Ptrl, and Ptrl will actually run your Storm job. So to create spout, so what I did actually is I load some random sentences of both Java and Python, and I'm just emitting over here. So I got a list of sentences that has Java and Python as a keyword. I'm selecting random sentence out of those list of sentences. And for each sentence, I am declaring the output field as a sentence, just to mark it as a something. So I use sentence over here, but if you don't use anything, it will use default keyword. And in the extract bolt, what I am doing is I am getting each sentence, I am splitting it with space, and I am counting whatever the words that are there in that. So for that, I am just splitting the sentence by space and just emitting the whatever the words that are there in that. So since I want only the count of Python and Java keywords, I'll be checking if that Python or Java keyword is there in the list of the words or not, and if it is there, I'm just emitting that word. And in the ranking bolt, what I'm doing is I'm getting all the sentences that have been tuples actually that have been emitted from the previous bolt. So this actually creates a map kind of thing. So for each Java, we'll be having counters. So when you get a Java word, it will actually count the number of instances that this bolt has been got. And this is how you create your topology. So first, you create what is spout, you name it as spout, and then you create bolt. So from this spout, it should go to extract word bolt, and then from extract word bolt, it should go to the compare bolt, where actually the comparison the comparison is happening. And for that, you have to use fields grouping, since you are getting count of each keyword that is available in the sentence. So fields grouping is required over here. So the sentence that have the same keyword as Java should go to the same instance of the other bolt. So for that, you have to use fields grouping. And for the other things, you can use normal shuffle grouping because it doesn't matter. And you can just submit your topology, whatever you have created, by this simple command. And this is how the results look like. Maybe you cannot see this. So the spout is actually emitting this Python is fast sentence, and then it is splitting over the space. So you get different keywords that are there in this sentence, and if it is a Python keyword as we have developed, so then it reaches to the same instance of the other bolt. So all the Python keywords will go to the same instance of the bolt 2, and all the Java related keywords will go to the other instance of the bolt 2. So by that you got all the count that is what you want. And next is our sentiment analyzer. So you can use TweePy library, and there are plenty of resources out there that you can use to make sentiment analysis. You can use Google API or Indico IO, but that is rate limited. But if you want to make a sentiment analysis, first you need to have some machine learning kind of thing so that you can remove the junk tweets that are there. Some tweets may be simply copy paste kind of thing, so you don't have to do the computation again and again. And also you can use CentiWordNet, where you can parse what's the subject or the noun or the verb and the word, and that will give you a score. So there are plenty of resources out there. You can use any of that for your sentiment analysis, and then you can run Storm with this. So with VP Spout, so we created a tweet listener, so that actually gets data from Twitter. So all the data that you got is stored in some queue, and from that queue we are actually reading through a spout. So now spout reads from a queue and pushes that data into different bolts. In the prettifying bolt, we are just ignoring all the special characters that are there by using ordinal thing. We are just replacing with space over here. And in the analyze bolt, we are just calculating what is the sentiment for that particular sentence that we are getting, and we are returning that particular tweet with the score that Indico IO has returned. And that's it. Any questions?
Hello. Yeah, you said that we have high availability implementation of Nimbus as well.
Correct.
So who is managing, you know, high availability of Nimbus?
So actually Zookeeper is the one that is doing leader election thing. If there are multiple instances of Nimbus,
Okay.
So zookeeper actually selects which should become the leader, and then okay. Nimbus will assign all the works and reassign the works if any supervisor is
done. So in case of cluster installation of Storm, so how you install zookeeper in this case? Where you install the configuration, you know, the JK CFG and all.
Yes.
How you install that?
So zookeeper basically it's a quorum kind of thing. Zookeeper itself is a distributed system, so you don't run zookeeper on one node. You run zookeepers on multiple nodes. Even if one node of the zookeeper fails, the other two will still be alive, and that will be serve the quorum purpose. And in recent 0.10 Storm, they have introduced Spacekeeper rather than using Zookeeper, because since they were using ephemeral nodes for heartbeat thing, so they were using Spacekeeper rather than Zookeeper. So that's how the process is done. So you select any three nodes in the cluster and then run Zookeeper on those three nodes.
One question. So do you have a job scheduling also at runtime in Storm? So basically you are doing something and suddenly you come up with some creating a jobs at runtime dynamically, okay. And then running parallel in, let's say, Bolt.
No, actually topology will be running continuous. There is no end for topology unless you kill it. So whatever streams that your Kafka is emitting or any other messaging system is emitting, So that will be fetched into topology, and that's how the distributed computing is done through Bolts. Is that, have I answered your question?
Do you have any advice on pushing this to production, any workflow or best practices sort of thing? First question. Second question, Spark versus Storm for the same use case.
So I'll give answer for the second question first. Spark versus Stream. Spark is for batching. It does batching actually. There is Spark streaming, definitely I agree, but that is for micro batching. But if you want to do real-time analysis kind of thing, then you can do Storm. Say if you want to have latency in milliseconds, if you want to say you are in trading thing and if you want to get ticks in milliseconds, then you can use Storm. But if you want to have in say in minutes or hours or maybe longer latency, then you can use Spark. And regarding the deployment in production, you have to consider what is the core of your each machine, how many machines you have, and then distribute in what machine should be the zookeeper be installed, what will be the Nimbus, and what are the supervisors. As of now, you can make only one thing as Nimbus and the remaining nodes as supervisors. You can use three zookeeper nodes, because that is the best practice that I have studied. If you maintain more zookeepers, then it will be more writing kind of thing into the Z nodes. So it's better to have three nodes so that the writes will be faster and the coordination is done at good.
Hi.
Yeah.
There is a question. You have given example for Java and Python. So there you have used the field grouping.
Yes.
So what's the reason we are not using other grouping that you have explained earlier in the slide?
So as I said, by fields grouping, you are actually controlling to which instance of the bolt you should actually send to. So since in the count, you are doing a dictionary kind of thing where you will be counting all the keywords that are there in all the sentences that have been emitted. So if Python keyword goes to different instances of the bolt, then each will have different counts, right? So that will actually not serve the purpose of getting the counts.
So you can correlate with partitioning. Let's say I am sending one signal. That same signal I want to count again and again. So I have to lend it to the same instance of the bolt.
So executors are
like, it will replicate, right? One count is here, another count is there.
So executors are nothing but threads actually, which are spawned by workers. So you should actually send to the same thread if you want to get your count in correct way. If you send it to different instances, your count will not be correct.
Any more questions?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you all.